If you'd have told me when I was a kid that I'd be on Radio 1 or MTV today and R&B would be massive in the charts week in, week out, I'd say, wake me up.
This is the story of Britain's soul boys and soul girls.
When I think of British soul, I think of Stevie Wonder, Bob Marley. You know what I mean? With that very innate African influence.
I've been a huge fan of black music, soul music, since the day my godfather bought me the Jackson's Greatest Hits when I was 7 years old. It was just something about it that just grabbed me, and I just said, I love this.
This is the story of Britain's struggle to prove you don't have to be born in Detroit to make a great soul record.
Between us, we created hip-hop soul, the very first hip-hop soul. Before Mary J, there was us.
It's about how we created a unique UK sound, all our own.
We pushed it in their face and said, listen, this is the dog's onyx. Yeah. This is what the streets are loving right now. You get me? And this is my organisation and this is my business plan. Yeah? I'm ready. Are you ready to take on something like this?
Soul music is just about feeling it. It's just a feeling in your bones. I've always wanted to look at the impact of soul music on this country because it's changed decade to decade.
Now R&B dominates the charts. It's easy to forget how far we've come. When I was growing up, it was a desert. You couldn't just turn on the radio or walk into HMV. To be a soul fan required commitment.
The driver went through the windscreen and the ambulance drivers jumped out and said, are you OK? Do you want to go to hospital? I went, no, I want to go to Wigan.
Wigan, weirdly, is where my journey kicks off, because for a soul fan in the early 70s, it was the centre of the world.
It was the first time you stopped out all night. Probably the first time you took drugs, first time you socialised with people from all over the country, all these firsts.
It meant everything to me. It's what we went to work for, to get your wages at the end of the week so that you could get down to Wigan at the weekend.
We're all doing shitey jobs. I want to fucking enjoy myself and I want to hear music that, ooh, lifts me up at the weekend.
Everyone thinks raving began in the 80s, but almost 20 years before House, when the rest of Britain was in bed by 10:30, you had 2,000 or 3,000 soul fans crossing the country to dance all night to stomping soul music. It was way before my time, but I've always wanted to know what it was about the music of black America that obsessed all these white working class kids in the North.
Northern soul was not contrived. I can relate to it. I don't know, maybe because I'm scum from the North, you know, and it's made by scum from Detroit. I can take care of myself, and without you I'd
make it. I'm gonna make it. We are on our way to Wigan, which is the spiritual home of Northern soul, and it's a place that I've never been to in my life and never thought I would ever be going to. Take my gear.
It was underground. Northern soul wasn't chart music. These were obscure flops from the 60s by Motown wannabes. A track like Gloria Jones's Tainted Love has got all the ingredients, a stomping four to the floor beat, searing vocal.
2:15 of high drama. There was always tales of misery, heartache, women being left in the lurch. And who think love is to play? Well, I'm
sorry, I don't play that away. It's the feelings of some guy belting his heart out in a studio with the last of his savings going on the record, and he sings his fucking heart out. And you can feel that it's actually his feelings coming out in the record.
I had to go and find the source of this fabulous music.
These songs had rawness, energy. Just knowing them made you feel special, and they pull kids to Wigan like a magnet.
It was a hoot of a journey. On average, it took about 14 hours to get there.
Jumped trains, begged, stole, borrowed cars, hitchhiked, you got there how you could.
So I've come to find the spiritual home of Northern Soul, and it's a porter cabin.
I'd agreed to spend the night at a Northern Soul gig, but the Wigan Casino was long gone.
As soon as the doors opened, there'd be people climbing over each other to try and get in first.
It'd be nice to see it.
The opening bars came on and time stood still.
You get this amazing sensation where the hairs on the back of your neck just rise.
It was just so exciting.
I was released from whatever stress, pain, misery that I had in my life. It just elevated you.
Okay, you mean to tell me I have driven 5 hours for this? It better be good tonight, that's all I'm saying. There better be at least one tune I like, or else Northern Soul can die for good. It's not a good start.
The only reason why I went that far north, because I think Spurs were playing. And here we were, stepping back into what appeared to be like, you know, Victorian England. You know, in an old music hall, wooden floors, talcum powder everywhere, sweat, and people literally dancing till they dropped.
It's just that combination of superb music, superb gear, and superb dancing combined.
Amphetamines were the order of the day for everybody.
Black Bombers, German.
Green and Clears and Blueies and Decks and Daps.
Probably fair to say, had there been no amphetamines, there would have been no all-nighters. And if there'd been no all-nighters, there would have been no such thing as Northern Soul.
They were proper pharmaceutical amphetamines. They just took them all and just enjoyed themselves.
There was never enough to go round. So there were a number of us that chose to liberate them from chemist shops. En route to an all-nighter somewhere, the car would just pull up and people would jump out, kick the front door in, run in, grab what they could and run out. A good pharmacist, all the drugs are in alphabetical order, and you would head for D. They mostly began with D. Dextrin, Drinamol, Drinamol Specials, Durafet, Depresil. Nearly all began with D.
Turning my heartbeat up, ooh-wee. Turning my heartbeat up, it's getting harder.
If there's a drum roll, you spin. You know, the record made you do what you did.
Turning my heartbeat up, I keep telling you, you're turning my heartbeat up.
The feeling when you spin and you hit it perfectly and you're spinning around and you hit on the brake, it's incredible.
Turning my heartbeat up, yeah.
It was embarrassing to say that you practiced, but you did, every fucker did.
It just makes you feel free because nowhere else would you ever do that. It was just kind of spiritual, I think.
Dancing for me was my liberty, you know, I was crap at school. That was my freedom. I got a
little girls were known for wearing the flared skirts, you know, and they used to sew washers into them so that when they spin, the skirts lifted up. The annoying thing was they were spinning, we were doing drops, and these fucking washers were crack off your fucking head, yeah, bastard.
Back in London, the girls were on the cutting edge of style and fashion. They looked great, to die for. But here were these girls who were just basically dressed in the most unsexy way you could imagine, because basically they dressed to dance.
It wasn't like you're going to wear your very best clothes. You're rolling about the floor covered in talcum powder, stinking of sweat. So it wasn't an attractive scene.
I wore trousers that were baggy. It was just as long as they were baggy at the genitals, because then you could dance and they didn't stick to you. If you didn't wear them, sometimes you get a rash around your balls the next day because you've been dancing with these sweaty breeks on.
I'm thinking, what are we doing here?
The weirdest thing of all is 20 years later, Northern Soul fans are still just as obsessed.
How can a man who's never been blue?
Two, please. Ringers.
When I walked in, yeah, I knew it was going to be white, but all those old Northern blokes were a bit of a shock.
Straight in, would you? Straight in.
Vinyl's a religion on this scene. I thought I was bad.
I like it.
Southern Soul started out as a tiny underground scene, but by the end of the 70s, the Casino had 100,000 members and had been voted best disco in the world by American Billboard magazine.
Eventually, about, 77, you started getting loads of sightseeing knobheadies turning up. And they were paying money to get in, so the promoters were quite happy in that. And certain DJs became lazy. They found they didn't have to dig for special tunes anymore. They could just play anything with a dancey beat, and these idiots would dance to it, you know, and think they were part of the Northern scene. And the music quality went way downhill.
The scene had been infiltrated, and it just wasn't pure anymore. It just wasn't what we'd all been there for.
It was shite. It was fucking shite. The Hawaii Five-O and the theme for the Fantastic Plastic Flying Machine, which they covered up as jealousy for ages, and, oh, wait a minute, and all that. They were atrocious.
But it wasn't just the music that was spoiling the fun at Wigan.
People got more and more into drugs and the music got shit. Strychnine blues. They used to turn your shit white. Right, used to crap white. I don't know what the technical term for that is, but that's your crap used to come out white, or used to freak me out. But you'd take 2 1-week, yeah, and you'd have a good time. So you think, right, next week I'll take 4. But they changed the strength, you know, because they're backstreet.
And the homemade stuff first came in. I mind there was an all-nighter in Wakefield, and there was like 8 or 9 folk dead in